Good evening, everyone. So back again in our online class. So it's session 3. We already have the third meeting today. So I'm sorry. So English first translation. Now I think in this third meeting, we have to translate a little bit hard. We need to discuss a bit harder than other previous topic, because now we need to translate examination report and then process report. You guys knew that this is not in our field. We learn English, but we not really familiar with the English usage in economic field or in other field. Jadi kali ini kita bakalan membahas about examination report and then process report. Kenapa saya bilang sulit? Karena ini tuh adalah English usage in penggunaan Inggris, bahasa Inggris di another field. How to say that? Di subject lain, bukan di jurusannya kita, which is economic subject, economy, English economy, or another one, because we focus on more casual, more into English, not like ada istilah-istilah ekonomi di dalamnya. We're not familiar with that. Kita tidak terbiasa, tidak mengenal apa itu. How is that? I'm sorry. Let me think. Istilah-istilah. Istilah-istilah atau bahasa yang digunakan di bahasa ekonomi. Nah, examination report ini adalah, as you can see there, a formal letter written by patent examiner who has assessed examined whether you application or what is it? Application or specification complies with the law and practice. The examination report informs you which part of your application and specification do not comply with the act. Jadi kalau kita mau ngelamar sesuatu atau kita ada proposal yang kita tujukan ke suatu perusahaan atau because here di sini kita bakalan bahas tentang kredit, simpan pinjam, kredit usaha atau sebagainya. Nah, di sini tuh pasti ada paper atau dokumen-dokumen yang perlu Anda lengkapi dan sebagainya. Nah, di application form Anda, di formulir pendaftarannya atau berkas-berkas seturut dengan form tersebut harus diperiksa dulu oleh pihak yang berkompeten di bidangnya. As you can see that written by a patent examiner. Jadi berkas-berkas Anda direview, diperiksa apakah ini layak untuk let's say karena ini berhubungan dengan kredit atau simpan pinjam, let's say apakah Anda sebagai pendaftar atau pemohon itu layak untuk diberi pinjaman atau sebagainya. Jadi berkas-berkas Anda akan diperiksa. Nah, hasil dari pemeriksaan berkas-berkas itulah yang disebut dengan examination report. Okay? Apakah kalian layak atau tidak? Apakah ada perlu berkas lain yang perlu Anda penuhi atau tidak? Jadi, it's more like kalau kita mau kredit sesuatu atau kita mau pinjam sesuatu, mereka itu kayak tinjau situasi, tinjau lokasi, atau tinjau keadaan kita. Nah, dalam hal ini tentu saja tinjau your finance, keuangan Anda, dan sebagainya. Nah, berikutnya adalah process report. Kalau tadi adalah examination report, di sini adalah process report. Explain how something is done or how something came about. It can be written in detail, step-by-step instruction, or in a story format with instructions subtly threaded throughout the narrative. A process essay has no minimum or maximum length, but 5 paragraphs is the norm, including introduction, 3 body paragraphs, and a conclusion. Jadi, Nah, kalau tadi examination report itu adalah hasil dari sesuatu, ya kalau ini tuh prosesnya. Misalnya, let's say pihak yang berkompeten tadi yang mau memeriksa situasi financial Anda, itu tuh datang, like, came to you, pasti ada prosesnya. Like, how they come to you, bagaimana cara mereka approaching you, mendatangi Anda, atau bagaimana cara mereka melakukan peninjauan tersebut, disitulah yang disebut dengan process report. Atau ini biasanya digunakan di bagian di field, biology field, medical field or something like that, bagian-bagian penelitian seperti itu, like kimia, fisik or something. Mereka sering melakukan research, penelitian tentang how do they come up with bagaimana, let's say, cara membuat ramuan or something like that. Like in medical or in farmasi, bidang farmasi, bagaimana cara mereka menciptakan obat atau something. So they have a process, bagaimana mereka they come up with hasilnya itu. Jadi ada step by step. Let's say they put something in there, mereka memasukkan cairan A, cairan B, dan hasilnya seperti ini. And then it says, di sini disebutkan bisa melalui step by step, like satu bla bla bla, dua bla bla bla, atau melalui teks naratif yang seperti kita lakukan. Jadi teks saja, proses like they flowing, not step by step. Jadi dalam bentuk paragraf, not satu dua tiga, like recipe or something. So di sini disebutkan a process essay has no minimum or maximum. Jadi tidak ada minimal sekian, maksimum sekian. But they have a norm. Jadi tapi ada rule-nya. It kind of confusing. If they say there's no tidak ada batasan minimal atau maksimal, tapi mereka sebutkan rules-nya. Ada biasanya more like they usually ada 5 paragraf is the norm. Like normalnya ada 5 paragraf sih, something like that, including introduction, three body paragraphs and conclusion. So pertama mereka start dengan introduction dulu, pengenalan kenapa mereka mau menciptakan sesuatu ini. Lalu selanjutnya adalah three body paragraphs, which is masuk ke stepnya, the prosesnya, proses cara pembuatan benda tersebut atau that things atau sesuatu itu, and then they conclude. Jadi hasil melalui proses-proses tersebut hasilnya ialah seperti ini, seperti ini, seperti ini, blah 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 blah. So that is process report. So I think it's kind of clear, but if you guys have any question, if not, then let's move on to language points in examination report. Jadi ada beberapa language point atau bahasa atau penggunaan pilihan kata yang digunakan di examination report. Seperti biasa, we all talk about this, like indefinite article. Article always, of course, because kita tidak bisa, how to say, without an article, we can start a sentence or something. So article is definitely the most common one that come up. Like the, an, it always, in every kind of text, every kind of paragraph, whatever it is, because we can just like car or something. We need to jadi ada artikel di situ untuk menjelaskan itu sesuatu itu apa. So and then my, may and might, adverb of frequency, between, among, for, relative clauses, preposition plus ing from an as. Kalau tadi itu examination report, they have a different, berbeda. Examination process report itu ada passive there, ada adjective plus infinitive, past, future, perfect tense, such as, another as a pronoun, phrasal verb to stand, link word, and ing form. Jadi mari kita bahas satu persatu language point-nya. Pertama adalah indefinite article. Well, again, we how to say, kita seringkali bahas ini. Like I was saying before, seperti yang saya sampaikan sebelumnya, why do they need article? Because in every situation, every kind of text, they always put article there. Because you can't just say, I buy book, it sounds weird. Jadi itu kedengaran aneh. I buy book, really? You buy book, what do you mean? Like, it sounds not really good. So you need to put something there. I buy a book, or the book that I bought yesterday, you know that I was bought it from the, you know, not really popular library or something. So you need to emphasize that thing. But here we in language point and examination report, they choose indefinite article. You guys know the difference, right? If it's just how to say plural jamak, they kind of use. If you don't really want to emphasize, jadi kalau tidak terlalu mau emphasizing atau menekankan that thing, you just simply say the. But if you want to emphasizing, like a book, a car, an apple, so you need an A. Why do they call that indefinite? Why definite and indefinite? Because in indefinite, they have two kind of article that follow by a noun. Let's see here. If your noun or your things or your words follow after the article, jadi kata benda atau kata kerja atau apapun itu, well, usually followed by noun, not a verb, I'm sorry. Jadi kalau kata kerja atau sesuatu yang diikuti setelah artikel itu adalah berawalan consonant, huruf mati, kita sebut itu huruf mati di Indonesia, we say A. But it's just simple like that. And then if that followed by a vowel, a vocal alphabet, a vowel, and then you start with N. That's the, as you can see in the example, a car and apple. As simple as that. Because it's indefinite, we can just put one definite article. Like, you can't, because the is complex. How to say? Dia bisa fit kemana aja. Like, the apple, the book, you can't use definite article because it's only one. But in indefinite, you can't just simply put A with apple. No, you can't do that. You need to choose between two. Whether jadi di antara dua itu mana yang paling fit, yang paling cocok dengan your noun, something like that. That's why they call it indefinite. Now it's start with may or might. It's a modal verb. May and might can normally be interchanged without significance. Oh, I'm sorry. So, it's another thing. The first one, how do you use may and might? Dimana kalian, bagaimana penggunaan use and may or might, penggunaan may and might in sentence? Apa sih arti may and might? If you find it in a sentence, jika Anda menemukan may and might, what is the function there? Apa gunanya may and might di situ? Stands for what is may and might there? Menjelaskan apa sih may and might itu? So, first, they show possibility. Jadi, kemungkinan di dalam kalimat itu. Jadi, kalimat tersebut, may and might di situ berfungsi untuk menjelaskan kemungkinan. First, as you can see in example, it might rain leather, so take an umbrella. Mungkin nanti hujan. So, can you please bawa payung aja, siapa tahu nanti hujan. It's pretty much like that. And you can't use may there. It may rain leather, so take an umbrella. But the difference is, as you can see here, it may rain, it might rain. They have a different chance. Jadi mereka punya kesempatan terjadi itu, kemungkinannya itu, persentase kemungkinannya itu bisa berbeda. Not bisa, well, definitely berbeda. First is, if you use may in your word, it means that you have more chance. Rain is their possibility, the kemungkinannya itu mungkin lebih besar. Bakalan hujan, kemungkinan bakalan hujan itu lebih besar daripada Anda menggunakan might. So as you can see here, like 70-40%. So yeah, if you guys, if you use may there, means that the kesempatan akan kejadian itu lebih besar. Yeah, it's simple like that. And then give permission. Memberi izin. You may have another cookie if you like. Silahkan diambil kuenya kalau mau. Gitu. and then ask for permission. May I borrow your pen, please? Like you asking something in a polite way. Like, boleh pinjam penanya enggak? And then express wishes, like you menyampaikan harapan-harapan Anda. How to say, like you give bless to someone, like may God bless you, may you have a blessed day, may you have a good years in front of you or something like that. Jadi menyampaikan sesuatu, something nice to people, like give a blessing or something. Like in the example, seperti yang ada di contoh, may the new year bring you happiness. Semoga tahun baru membawa kebahagiaan untuk kamu ya. Like, let's say, you guys, how to say, sometimes your friends, jadi ada teman yang ulang tahun, you always like, happy birthday, friends. May you have a lot of good things happen. May God bless you and blah, blah, blah. Right? And then speculate about past action. As you can see, there's speculate, like spekulasi. Jadi kayak Anda menciptakan suatu skenario yang sebenarnya belum tentu benar, tapi it might be true, it might not. Boleh bisa benar, bisa enggak. Tapi it's just your assumption. Jadi cuma sekedar asumsi aja. Like there, she is late. She may have missed her plan. Like they create that assumption. Sesuatu yang menyebabkan mbaknya itu terlambat. So, yeah, speculate about past action. Okay? So, here, we have another kind of definition, well, pretty much the same. Like, we use them when there is a possibility of it happening. Jadi, kita menggunakan may and might ketika kita tahu bakalan ada kemungkinan. There must be a chance, possibility, kemungkinan akan kemungkinan kejadian tersebut terjadi. And here, I may go to Edinburgh tomorrow, perhaps like 50%, but here he said that 50, here he said 70, but the point is may always go higher chance rather than might. Jadi selalu, well, as you can see here, 50, and here is 30, so, and Peter might come with me, might, like, perhaps a 30% chance, it is possible, but not very likely to happen, like, not very likely to happen, that the key point. Jadi, lebih besar kemungkinan itu nggak terjadi. Nah, kalau di sini tuh, kemungkinan terjadinya itu lebih, they more into, mungkin terjadi. Nah, kalau di sini tuh, mungkin nggak datang, it's, how to say? Jadi might ini like you say something in a nice way, like you some say kayak Anda tuh menolak atau say the opposite thing, but in a nice way, like here. Mungkin Peter datang, like you say that dia nggak bakalan datang sih sebenarnya, cuman saya mau bilang dia datang aja biar kalian nggak kecewa. It's pretty much like that. So you soften. You soften your assumption. You soften your statement. You got it? Okay. Next, we have adverb of frequency. We already talked about it in the last two... No, in the first session. Jadi ada adverb of frequency. As you can see, that frequency. How to say frequency? Like, sering. Frekuensi sesuatu, ukuran kejadian sesuatu. Like, we have, ada empat yang basic one. The basic one, we have four kind of adverb of frequency. Seberapa sering kejadian itu terjadi. Seberapa sering Anda melakukan sesuatu. Like, seberapa sering sih, how often you guys check your phone? Seberapa sering kalian ngecek handphone atau, yeah, take a look at your phone. Well, there's four types. Like, never, often, sometimes and always. So the measure to make it easy, there has a thermometer there. Jadi untuk mempermudah teman-teman sekalian, ada di sini ada thermometer. Nah, when the thermometer is empty, jadi ini empty, well empty then never, tidak pernah. You never touch your phone. never, like, nah, no, it's not possible. You guys always check your phone, but not like never. Well, often, let's say often, or always, not really always, because you have pasti mbak-mbaknya itu ada. Well, you have something to do other than checking your phone, right? But yeah, let's say often, because now you like you call your mom, you call your family, or atau berhubungan dengan kerjaan atau ngomongin tugas sama teman-teman. Well, often, use that. So yeah. Adverb of frequency adalah adverb yang digunakan untuk menjelaskan seberapa sering suatu kejadian dikerjakan. Pretty much like that. And the next one is between and among. So, there's a difference between There's a difference between between and among. I'm sorry. Jadi ada perbedaan di antara dua these two words. So between is used in speaking of or choosing or differentiating between two types of people. So the key word itu two things, dua. Jadi penggunaan between di kalimat itu kita gunakan jika kita if we compare, jika kita mau membedakan dua benda atau two somethings like people, benda atau apapun itu, but between two. Well, among is involving three or more. Kalau tadi between itu hanya di antara dua saja. Nah, kalau among itu, jika lebih dari dua dong. Like, tiga or more. Tiga atau lebih. As an example, among. Like, an elk stood among the trees. Jadi, trees-nya itu lebih dari dua. There are not two trees there. A lot of trees there. So, they artinya sama, still di antara. But how do you use that? Kapan sih penggunaan between and among itu? So yeah, here's the example to make you easier, because it's not only two tree, but more trees there. Ada banyak pohon, so they use among. An elk stood among the trees. Bisa berdiri di antara pohon-pohon. But here, Annie's shop is between the library and the diner. Between. There's only two there to compare. Jadi ada library. Ada perpustakaan dan a diner. How do you say that? A diner. Like a small cafe. Atau, yeah, a small cafe. Atau rumah makan. So that's between and among. Let's go to defining relative clause. So there's two kind of relative clause. The first one is give relevant information, and then give extra information. So what's the difference between defining and non-defining? Nah, kalau defining itu, we give relevant information, and then why they have to put relevant or why they put extra? Because in defining clause, you put something. Jadi, menyatakan sesuatu, lalu ada informasi yang tambahan informasi di kalimat Anda itu. Tapi, jika informasi tambahan yang Anda berikan itu dihilangkan dari kalimat itu, let's say you take it out, nah kalimatnya tuh bakalan aneh. Kalimatnya jadi, you can't get the point in your sentence. Jadi, kalimatnya bakalan jadi berbeda artinya. But if non-defining, just give extra information. Here, the key point is extra. Just an extra one. Jadi kalau dihilangkan informasinya itu, tetap artinya sama. You still got the point. Let's just move to example to make it easier. First is, my mother, who is 51 years old, works in an office. So here, who is 51 years old? If you just put it out, jadi kalau misalnya ini kalimat who is 51 year, this is what we call clauses, like, yeah, clauses, relative clauses. That, but this one is non-defining. Why is it non-defining? Because if you put it out, jika who is 51 years old ini dihilangkan dari kalimat itu, tetap aja, artinya tetap sama. Mama saya kerja di kantor. That's it. Now, let's move to the next example. Which is divining. Nah, if it adds essential information, like they said there, memberi informasi yang, how to say it, like worth it, yang benar-benar berguna, like if you put it there, then I will more understand. Jadi kalau kasih informasi itu, saya lebih ngerti apa maksud Anda. Let's just put an example. My teacher is the woman who is speaking on the phone. So you see, the relative clauses they give is who is speaking on the phone. So if this clause, jadi jika yang kalimat ini, clause ini dihilangkan dari kalimat itu, my teacher is the woman. Dah, okay, which woman? Nah, terus wanita yang mana guru kamu gitu. Jadi kalimatnya itu hilang arti yang sebenarnya. You got what I mean, right? Jadi guru saya adalah ibu yang sedang ngomong di telepon itu. Nah, kalau yang sedang ngomong dihilangkan, probably ada banyak ibu-ibu di situ. Terus yang mana ibu yang mana? So divining, like memberi informasi tambahan yang benar-benar guna, yang benar-benar fungsi tambahan itu. So that's a divining clause. Next one, we have preposition for first. I'm sorry. Preposition plus ing form. Well, you guys know what is preposition. We already talked about it. This preposition of location, time, and movement. We use a lot of them in text. Like location. Where are you now? I'm in office. I'm lay on my bed. So yeah, menyatakan tempat in and on. And then time, after, before, by, during, blah 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 blah. And then movement, against, along, down, from, off, on, onto, whatever. Now, let's put it. Mari kita, how do you say that? Let's mix them together, combine them together, preposition and then ing form. So here's some example of that. Are you interested in working for us? So you can see that in and then working. Like, let's say, I am in the class studying. So in, preposition, and then studying, right? Pretty much like that. So it just, you use preposition and then followed by ing form. Next, passive. Already talk about it several times. So I don't think we need to explain further about this, right? I already explained it in the first meeting, I think, and the second meeting also. So active voice. The voice, like, you can see that you stole a cookie from the jar. Active is more focused on someone does the action, like we focus on the subject. But the passive one is what kind of object? You see, you stole the cookie from the jar, but with passive we refer that. Jadi kita putar balik. Nah, the object goes in the front. Jadi objeknya itu jadi letaknya itu di depan. So the cookie was stolen from the cookie jar. As you can see in the passive. Nah, kalau di passive itu biasanya subjeknya itu tidak begitu penting, jadi tidak terlalu di mention. Okay, let's move on. We have adjective plus infinitive. Let's see. The example, it is nice to have a place of your own. Just pretty much combine. Jadi itu simple. Sesimpel itu, mereka cuma put an adjective followed by infinitive to blah blah blah. Like, it is happy to see you got married. Jadi, saya senang deh kamu akhirnya menikah. So pretty much like that. Easy. Now, past, future, perfect tense. Kind of confusing. Past and future. So, here's the explanation. Past, future, perfect tense used to explain an activity which would have been done in the past. Which would means that yang mungkin akan dikerjakan. Tapi tetap aja tuh ngomonginnya tuh di masa lalu. It was already happened, but more like you seandainya saja, like it happened 3 years ago, let's say 3 years ago, what would happen 3 years ago? So like you predict something, like conditional sentence types 3. Jadi nanti kita bakalan bahas conditional, apa itu conditional, jenis-jenis conditional. Nah di sini tuh dijelaskan kalau kejadian yang seandainya saja, tapi they still not happen, tapi tuh emang gak terjadi, kita tuh cuman pengen itu terjadi. Ya ampun, seandainya saja ya aku kemarin tuh seperti ini, pasti itu gak kejadian. So pretty much like that, it already happened, like you regret it. Jadi kayak kalian tuh nyesal atau seperti itu. And the next one we have present verb to stand. We often talk about the present verb. Kalau yang kemarin kita bahas to cut, now we talk about stand. The stand down, stand for, stand in for, stand out, stand up, and blah blah blah. So here's there's the meaning of what present verb stand down means, like leave, go, or give up. Like I'm stand down for everything. I'm stand up. Like you want guys to choose a food. Jadi kalau misalnya teman-teman arguing about a food, mau makan apa hari ini? I'm stand down for anything. Aku sih terserah, mau makan apa aja terserah. Like you give up, you don't have much choice. Yeah, whatever. Pretty much like that. So here's the stand, present verb stand. There's 1, 2, 3, 4. There's the view of them. So here the meaning. You can see yourself. So the next one we have link word. As you can see, link word. Kata sambung. So there's a lot of type of link word to show continuation, to give an example, to complete, to emphasize. Jadi ada beberapa jenis, like to show continuation, like untuk menunjukkan sedang kelanjutan kalimat tersebut, atau memberi contoh, menyimpulkan, dan menekankan. That's like give an example. Let's say for example, I love art. For example, I love music, I love dance, I love blah 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 blah. So art is the main idea, and then they give an example of art. Jadi dia kasih contoh art yang bagaimana sih yang dia suka. So she mentioned music, dance, or lukisan, drawing or something. So yeah, it's like you have two sentences for example, and then you combine them by using link word. Ada dua kalimat atau dua paragraf atau dua jenis apapun itu. Nah, untuk menyambungkannya, karena mungkin kalimat tersebut harus they still have a connection. Jadi ada masih berhubungan, jadi Anda menggunakan link word. Pretty much. The next one we have ing. Okay, ing form, well, easy. Ada 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Ada 5 jenis bentuk kata kerja, atau ya bentuk kata kerja di English. Ada best form like eat and walk. As you can see in the example, eats and walks, eat and walk. Jadi masing-masing bentuk ini stands for ada jenis penggunaannya. You can just randomly use, jadi tidak asal digunakan, tapi ada rulesnya when you use that, how to say, when you use that kind of verb. Jadi ketika Anda menggunakan verb itu, ada rulesnya, ada aturannya. Like ing, you use ing form jika situasi atau keadaannya Anda sedang masih kejadiannya itu masih berlangsung, or continuation. Like eating, I am eating right now. Saya lagi makan loh, something like that. Okay, I'm walking there. Okay, aku jalan ke sana ya. Pretty much like that. So that's ing. Oh, I think that's what we have, guys. Thank you so much. If you guys have any question or something, let me know. We can talk in our group, and see you next week. Thank you.